All right, we're going to go ahead and get started with Morty's talk this afternoon. My name is Brett Breer, Associate Professor of Urban Dimensions of Natural Resources. And Morty's talk today is sponsored by our department as well as the Africa Center of the School for Global and SOGIS. Let's go with that. get in front of a crowd, something you can't remember stuff. So we're very happy to have Morty, not just here this afternoon. We're fortunate to have him here the whole semester. This year, where he's teaching a couple classes for our department, as well as working on some conference planning and just kind of all that overall good collaborative type of stuff. And he first visited here in 2004, I think we figured it was, after our department head Mike met him at the World Parks Congress in Durban and was sort of impressed with Morty's presentation as a PhD student at the time. And then this was very early on in my career as an academic, because I remember Mike entrusted me to go to the hotel and bring Morty to campus. And when you're early in your career, any sort of validating moment by your department head means a lot. Like, okay, he thinks I'm confident enough to go meet our guest scholar and bring him here. But Morty's had especially in the last number of years, a great partnership with him, as well as his wife and organization that he is now running, both supporting our conservation leadership through learning graduate students, as well as helping out on some other projects that we have going on over there. So he's, kind of the typical introduction, he's been working in conservation for 16 years, originally as a carnivore ecologist, and then has been the executive director of a nonprofit in the Laikipia region of Kenya. And then as of a few years ago, struck it on his own to start his own conservation consulting firm with big visions for what that's going to accomplish as Kenya kind of really goes through some very positive and controversial changes in how it's going about practicing conservation. And one of the things that I appreciate about Morty, which I think you will pick up on today, is sort of his willingness to say provocative, controversial things and to put tough topics out there that need to be talked about, particularly in a place like Kenya, where conservation has, some roots in history and colonialism and how that plays itself out very recently, in fact. So one of the things that I really like about him a lot is being able to sort of say tough stuff. He's a hopeful cynic, so I can relate to him really well. And Morty, we're happy to have you here, of course, for the semester, and look forward to your talk for his book, The Big Conservation Lie.
Thank you very much, Brett. So it's a small book, but it's a small book that I hope will gain some momentum of ideas in other people. I didn't intend this to be a reading, so there's only one section from this book I'm going to read, and it's where we start. And it follows up from that phrase there, have you ever seen a black man on animal planet? I read this excerpt. Have you ever seen a black man on animal planet? Asked a Nigerian comedian. This was a stand-up comedy show in Kenya some time back. And his audience became silent. And he volunteered and said that you won't see a black man on animal planet. You'll only see white men. Because white people are never afraid. He was referring to the way they handle the wild animals and all that and get up close to them. And he said, they only become afraid when you go to the embassy seeking a visa. Then they tell you, I'm afraid we cannot give you a visa. This was in jest, but as you all know, Animal Planet is an American cable channel owned by Discovery Communications and immerses viewers in scintillating reality stunts exclusively performed by white people before an audience of over 98 million Americans and hundreds of millions from other countries. He might have been joking, but the image of white men, they are mostly male characters, taking to the wild, devoting their lives to saving wild animals and engaging in sensually captivating adventures has forever been used to drive the point home. As the planet experiences immense destruction of species, habitats, and ecosystems, it's only white people who really care. Conservation, as a result, is now almost exclusively associated with whiteness in Africa. So the big conservation lie. My talk is going to be pretty much about where this book comes from and why it happened, because indeed it's a book that wasn't much planned. It's a book that happened. It draws on experiences myself and my co-author had over our careers. My co-author is actually a journalist, so he's not from the conservation field, although he writes on conservation issues. And we shared a lot of correspondence and similar concerns from our different perspectives. I first met him when the organization I worked for built a fence to separate elephant habitats from farmlands and effectively to try and mitigate human-wildlife conflict that was a serious problem, still is, in Laikipia, Kenya. And he wrote an article in the newspaper saying that they're building a great fence to separate the haves and the have-nots. And a lot of my board members were appalled by that and came to me, you have to write something to the paper, sort of a rebuttal to that. And I got down and looked at the map. The people on one side were pretty much the haves, and the people on the other side were the have-nots. It was not the intention, but that's the fact of how it was. And that's how we started relating with John Barry. And after some years, I told him that we should write something together. And he said, I've written too many things for magazines, short articles. We have to write a book. That's the only thing that's worth the time and the fact that when you write a book, it lasts. Newspaper articles get forgotten and all that. So what we are looking for is to make a statement that will last. So chapter one asks, how did we get here? And leading up from that, sort of logically, the next question would be, where are we? And here is a cartoon that I think sort of illustrates part of where we are, certainly the part of Kenya where I am. You have charismatic endangered wild species in a rangeland non-protected area that is used pretty much like a Trojan horse that covers up for the militarization, fencing, and basically annexation of vast lands. That's simply how it is. In many parts of Africa, conservation goes along with controlling lands in one way or another. It's rarely practiced at the level of just looking at the species and the issues. It always includes controlling lands for better or for worse. And you see the pastoralists, they're running away from the guns with their cows and goats. And it's instructive, the relative size of the people. The practitioners are huge, the tourists are huge, pastoralists are really small. That's how it happens. So how did we get to this stage with all our expertise, all the knowledge, this amazingly interconnected world where we should know what's going on? I mean, we know what's going on in Wall Street. People know the numbers. Very little can be hidden there. The Securities and Exchange Commission will catch up with you if you try anything underhand. How did we get to this place in conservation? Despite everything we know, despite Discovery Channel, despite the internet, we travel so much now, we are really sophisticated tourists now. And it lies in a mystery that actually the publisher of this book, who is another hopeful cynic, as Brett would call him, we had a discussion and we found that there's a duality in conservation. In fact, you might call it duplicity, because I think a good part of it is deliberate, is that conservation is on the left when you're in the West, but it's on the right when you're in Africa. And in many instances, it's the very same people who are on the left here, but get on a plane, land in Nairobi, firmly on the right. And it's crucial to understand, if there's any take-home message I'd like you all to have, it's the understanding of this duality. because then suddenly everything becomes clear. So I like using footwear to illustrate my points. apologies to Birkenstock Company. When you're in the West, yeah, you stick on the left. That's, you're on the left, you're liberal, you're peaceful, you're green, you drive a hybrid car or you cycle. You're inclusive, you sort of love everyone and all that. Have a flower tucked behind your ear and that kind of thing. Proletarian. That's what conservation people are when you're here. A lot of the websites, this is a website of African Wildlife Foundation. You can see when they ask you to donate, there's a love heart there. I'm not, it kind of struck me, but they know who they're aiming for. That love heart is not aimed at people in Kenya, even though AWF's headquarters in Nairobi. It's aimed at people out here. So you donate, and your money, the gentleman or lady wearing the Birkenstocks donates her money. And what does your money go through? Go to? You find former commandos, special forces, defense contractor types, mercenaries being used in conservation. And you know Blackwater and all that. No left leaning person wants to even imagine that. But conservation organizations they've got this thing down really smooth. You give your money, it goes to mercenaries, and you're happy about it. You think of the love heart, you don't think about the guns. So this is what's happening. When in Africa, we transition seamlessly to the right. Again, there's the boots. That's what it's about in Africa. Conservative, very conservative. Not changed at all since, not changed appreciably since the mid-20th century in thinking, technique, and everything. Conservation is the one area where you can find a PhD scientist can do research and come up that the solution of what to our problem here is a fence. Something the Chinese did 3,000 years ago. But it's still acceptable in conservation 2017. PhD, NSF grant, and all that, you come up with solution, fence, barbed wire. Very conservative, we don't change. It's militarized. You'll notice that a lot of you are familiar with conservation operations in the US. There's no guns. In Kenya and a lot of Africa, it's militarized, absolutely. There's guns, there's boots, there's helicopters, and lots of ammunition. Again, green and brown, fatigues, four-wheel drive vehicles. It's very exclusive. Very exclusive, a very small club, very small number of people talk about it. It's very elitist, even tourism is very elitist. Sport hunting, where it happens in Africa, is very elitist. Either foreigners or very wealthy locals. It's not like what you have in the US where every Tom, Dick and Harry has a gun in the truck and goes out when the season is on and does his sport hunting. Africa, it's absolutely elitist. And with gun laws, the gun laws we have, like in Kenya, most of us live our whole lives and die without ever holding or firing a gun. I've only fired a gun once, and it was somewhere in rural Pennsylvania. It wasn't even in Kenya. that's how it is. We don't do that. So it's forcefully elitist. We have walls and very strong barriers to new thought coming in. Then it's intrusive and oppressive. I'll tell you a few more things about that. Then the elephant in the room, if you will, is the fact that it's often racist. I like the fact that with all the problems that are there in the US, racism is something people can talk about. In Africa, people, it's anathema. You don't talk about it. You know it, you feel it, you practice it, but you do not talk about it, certainly not in conservation. very few people will accept that this problem exists in conservation. It certainly does in Kenya. And when you get sensitive, when you get sensitive to it, I'm not sure what sensitized me to it. When you get sensitive to it, immediately people treat you like you're an oddball. Suddenly you can't fit in. Your ideas, people don't know how to deal with your ideas. I resigned from the editorial board of that prominent magazine because of that cover. A very serious animal welfare issue, obviously, but they called it the slave trade. And I told them, no, we cannot have that. The slave trade is what you see on the right there, a tragic era in human history that cannot be taken casually. You cannot compare a chimpanzee taken out of Africa to people taken out of Africa. And they couldn't get what I was saying. So I got up, put together my files, and walked out. To this day, they still don't understand what I was talking about. So this is accepted. And therein lies our problem. We cannot allow ourselves to embrace new ways of looking at things. The things that, and the human condition demands change. The things that were accepted years ago but sound crazy now. It's a few decades ago, children with behavioral problems were treated using electric shocks. It was done. And it was considered the acceptable practice. But that's anathema now. This is why conservation needs a real sort of stiff nudge in the ribs, which is what my co-author and I expected or want this book to be. And it's also important, it's probably even more important that the people in the West, yourselves, in the US, in Europe, Asia, wherever, and also understand this. Because I know the resources, the dedication that people from here put into conservation in Africa comes from a good place. I need to believe that. But there are some brokers in between the US and Kenya that seamlessly twist this thing into something that serves their own aims at the other end. So we need to look, I'd like us to look closely at what's happening with our conservation organizations. The Nature Conservancy, as an example, is a very prominent organization both here, over here, and in Africa. But there's a huge gulf in between what they do here and what they do in Kenya, where I come from, or in Tanzania. I was baffled when reading about their projects, and I found that they're involved in birth control initiatives as part of conservation projects. And you talk to people and people say, well, of course, there's too many people. Duh. Population growth, et cetera, is a serious issue. But it is not to be handled by conservationists. These are people. These are not wild animals. They're not ecology, carrying capacity, and the life tables, and those kind of things. These are people. So there's a Ministry of Health or whatever. I mean, if you look at how issues of birth control are treated in the US, it's very delicate, spoken about at length, a lot of arguments. It's a very heavy topic, even politically, as it should be. It's not a small matter, but here we have conservation interests getting involved in it. I looked at Pathfinder International, their partner who is doing that with them, and looked on their website. The only place that they do work all over the world, but the only place where they do it in relation to conservation is in Africa. So there's some of these problems that are getting pretty exclusive to Africa, and they hark back to the diminution of the population, the small people, whose interests, etc., matter less. As part of the shift to the right wing in Africa is a common practice, now getting common, I refer to it as state capture. NGOs, civil society, non-profits, again here they're working in the outside government, but when they go there, they get straight into bed with government. This particular picture was there's an NGO called Space for Giants, for elephant conservation. The gentleman in the dark suit and blue shirt is the CEO, and he created something called the Giants Club that he's getting heads of state to sign on to. And sadly, he's now got, I think, about 5 heads of state of African countries to sign on. There is our clueless president signing on. I'm not sure how a president, sitting president of a sovereign nation, signs on to a club. I don't know if we are now all in the club or if it was just him. But anyway, that happened. This was last year. The latest join is Botswana. So what is the Giants Club? And I'll tell you, this is a grab from their website. Apparently, not only for heads of state, business leaders can also join at a certain financial commitment, which is not mentioned. If obviously I wouldn't qualify. But the thing is, what are the benefits? I just want to draw the attention to the circle on the left. You get access to heads of state by joining that club. And they're asking, if you look at global business leaders, and they at the bottom sentence, you see natural resource corporations in Africa. Now, those are mining corporations. Those are oil exploration interests. So this guy is peddling influence and access to heads of state under the guise of conserving elephants. Simple as that. The elephants are just the window dressing. What's going on here is much, much bigger. The guy on the extreme left in the white jacket is Yevgeny Lebedev, who is the patron of this organization. He's a Russian oligarch. You can imagine the people lining up to get access to Uhuru Kenyatta, president of Kenya. So how did we get sidelined like this? And the other question we ask is, in the book, is so, do indigenous Africans actually know anything about conservation? Do they care? What do they think about conservation? I dare say those organizations listed there don't think so, certainly judging by what they're doing in Africa. And although it might seem obvious that people must know something about conservation, or else there wouldn't be all this wonderful wildlife. So this is the problem, is that all these organizations that do a lot of reasonable conservation work all over the world, when they get to Africa, it's about moving people out. To conserve anything, you must remove people from this place. You must secure this place, fence it, etc., despite everything we know about habitat fragmentation. We are all about fencing, remove people from this area. And a lot of times this goes pretty bad. There's this video, it's a feature by BBC Channel 4 about conservation's dirty secrets, about the piece of land that was purchased by AWF, African Wildlife Foundation, as a proxy of the Nature Conservancy in Laikipia, Kenya. And it had some pastoralists grazing the animals on it. And they moved in to get people out. And in the process of doing that, it was a violent eviction. Houses were burnt, people were killed. TNC got off pretty clean. AWF remained with all the mud on its reputation. So TNC was far enough in the background that unless you really looked at the issue, you wouldn't know they were involved. But this is the amazing transformation of civil society organizations into armed, strong arm tactics, human rights violations that you hear civil society talk about all the time. So that is the duplicity of conservation as it's practiced right now. Again, another opinion of indigenous Africans' knowledge or lack thereof in conservation. Look at that picture. It's called a heartwarming photo essay, Kenyans protecting their wildlife. That's not conservation going on there. That's a man sleeping in a stable with a wild animal when he should be home with his family. But this stuff sells. Which brings me to the other thing. This stuff sells. So it's about money. It's about money. We drift further and further from the principle that conservation is towards simple, old-fashioned material gain. Actually, I'd prefer like an oil corporation. They're honest. They tell you, we want oil. We want oil and want to sell it because this will make money. Can we do a deal? They're straight up. But this is what's happening. And again, WWF is under examination by OECD right now for human rights violations in both Cameroon and Gabon as they are establishing forest reserves and evicting people who've lived in those forests for generations. Because suddenly they are not, to conserve this forest, we need to get rid of these people. So there are a lot of things that go wrong. And so how does all this fly? There's a lot of much lesser ills that get picked up on around the world. But how does this fly? And that brings me again to the question of race as pertains to conservation practice in Africa. I've used that photo is of that picture is of George Adams, one of the pioneer wildlife wardens in Kenya. He died about 30 years ago. And his claim to fame was hand-raising some lion cubs, which became the subject of a movie, Born Free and Living Free. And in all that adulation, obviously, it escaped everyone that he only got to have those cubs because he killed the parents. But anyway, he became this wonderful lion conservationist. And now we have Kora National Park is where he was doing this. And this Kenya Wildlife Service put up this is a promotional sticker. So apparently, all the wonderful landscapes and biodiversity in Kora National Park didn't matter. What was important is that George Adamson lived there. It's the need for Caucasian validation of whatever you're saying. George Adamson becomes the value of Kora National Park. Bizarre as that seems, but this is what's going on. So it's not only a problem of the ills that are done by people coming in to practice or bring conservation. There is a definite intellectual and policy vacuum that these people are coming into. And I think right up there, a good chunk of the blame lies with our institutions, as in Kenya, in Tanzania, and other countries. Because the structures of conservation as practiced in Africa, in much of Africa, is what came down from the colonial days. And what was introduced by the colonialists, Kenya and many other African countries were colonized in the Victorian era. So what was introduced was what Victorian gamekeepers used to do. Those of you read, if you can read the history, the duty of Victorian gamekeepers was to keep the commoners from utilizing any of the wildlife for survival so that the nobles could use it for recreation. That was their basic mandate. And that was what was brought in, and that's what we have failed to change. So a lot of things last amazingly long in Africa. This is John Speke, a British explorer credited with discovering the source of the Nile. The 1860s, exploring Africa on a parasol being carried by some porters while being admired for walking hundreds of miles. So that was back then. This is Uganda 2015. So what's changed? Apart from the nice hiking boots the lady is wearing, and she's not going to hike. So it's amazing how some things, cultural, some patterns of thought get stuck in this time warp. How is that acceptable anywhere? Yet this is not like a sneaky photo, candid camera thing. This is from a tourism brochure. They're advertising this. And this is where people going to view gorillas. So you need to hike a bit to go see the gorillas in their habitat. So some people don't feel like hiking. You get carried there. And again, then we attach conservation in Africa a lot to personalities. Because a lot of you are in the conservation field or studies, you're familiar with these names. If you just think about them. How many of you can come up with any of them that's not white in 2017? This is a question, this is a rhetorical question, but it's one we have to ask ourselves. Why is it that there must be somebody somewhere? Why don't we know them? What is it that manages to so effectively hide whatever they invest in terms of effort in all this? And if we look at some of the much loved figures, if you look at Jane Goodall, and she's a wonderful lady, I've met her. And she works in Gombe Stream, Tanzania. Since 1975, there's been an embargo on that park, so tourists don't visit it. So it's hers exclusively for research. And there's been information, there's been depredation by chimpanzees on human children, horrifying as that sounds, in southwestern Uganda. It's also happened in Gombe. And I know people who are involved in it, and the Jane Goodall Foundation went overboard to suppress that news because chimps are supposed to be wonderful. I think chimps are horrible. They're too much like us, if I'm to be absolutely frank with you. But the fact is, when somebody's hype, somebody's narrative becomes more important than any of the issues or the species being conserved, it becomes a problem. In May 2002, a chimp called Frodo, one of her study animals, actually walked up to one of the ranger's wives, snatched the baby off her back, and went and ate it. And there was no problem animal control taken. The chimp wasn't shot or anything. The report filed by Jane Goodall's research people was that she was walking on a path she shouldn't have been walking on. That's how wonderful chimpanzee conservation is. Well, you all know what happened when a child fell into a gorilla enclosure in Cincinnati, I think. Yeah. The gorilla didn't have a chance. He was shot very quickly. Diane Fossey died sometime in the 80s. Rwanda-based gorilla conservationist, worked and lived alone. She was running anti-poaching militia gangs involved in all sorts of rights violations. She was murdered in her camp in 1985. Very much admired pioneer gorilla researcher. Saved the gorillas. Daphne Sheldrick hand-raised 160 elephants over 55 years. No ecological basis for what she's doing. She's the author of the One Killed Every 15 Minutes campaign. She gets a lot of money for this. 160 elephants out of 350,000. Well, statistical significance comes to mind there, but she's called a conservationist. Major elephant person in Kenya, Ian Douglas Hamilton, he's much credited with the linking of ivory poaching to terrorism funding. And I've seen me and rightly linked the Chinese market to as a driver for ivory trade. But now it's turned around, and I've talked to the officers, some of the officers in Save the Elephants, and they're now saying how wonderful China has become because they've decided that they're going to ban ivory trade after a year. I think the ivory trade in China is still horrible. If a carjacker says, I'm going to stop carjacking, violently robbing people in a year, you don't praise him. No. You keep quiet, if not share some choice words with him. But this is the politicking that has overtaken conservation. It's about politicking and horse trading and moving resources around and getting funding from here and all there. We've become We've become slaves to the sources of funding. And sadly, the funding in many instances has become an end in itself, not the addressing or solving of problems. Chapter 5 in the book talks about many myths that have come up. I mean, only conservation is only rivaled by ancient Greece in terms of the myths we come up with. They're very colorful, very romantic, very enjoyable, but they're myths. One of them is this movie by this guy, Brian Christie. Absolute myth. Saying that they created a fake elephant tusk in a lab somewhere in DC and it was good enough to fool poachers. Guys who handle tusks every day, who lay their heads on tusks at night, who trade in ivory, and he claimed that he left it in the bush and poachers picked it up and they tracked it with some tracking device. It went into South Sudan, crossed the border and disappeared. And from that, they concluded that the president of Sudan, Omar al-Bashir, was trading in ivory. He showed, part of the movie shows him landing in Tanzania and being thrown into a cell because the customs people couldn't believe the tusks were fake despite the documentation. That might be true, but the fact that he got into the cell with the movie camera and did the filming, no. Anyone who knows anything about jails in East Africa will know you don't even go in there with shoes, let alone movie cameras and lights. So, but this feeds the, we have a public, we have an audience that needs this so badly. And I think for those of us who understand what really goes on, we have a duty to give that public, that audience, the true picture. Because it's only in that way that we will really make a difference as far as conservation is concerned. I really don't think there's any other way. It's difficult, but it's something we have to embrace. Because when we build these myths, there are people we can't question. Because we've built them, we've put them up there, they control funding streams, Congress listens to them, USAID listens to them, NSF listens to them, so we are terrified. So one of the first people who I showed a draft of the book, whose opinion I cared about, was Brett. And Brett asked me, "My God, are you really gonna burn these bridges?" And I thought about it and I realized that those bridges, I was not allowed to cross any of those bridges, so they were not helpful to me. Then I, after thinking about what Brett said, I said, okay, then now we'll definitely write the book. Yeah. But that's the truth of the matter. I'm sure many of you know many people in Africa, I mean, indigenous Kenyans, Africans from other nationalities, highly qualified, who know what's going on, but are silent. They're silent, they won't say a word because they like the big office, they like the big SUV, they like the trips around the world. That's we've been reduced to work into that. So it's very much an indictment of us as the citizens of those client states. Again, the myth of one every 15 minutes. If you see at the bottom there, at this rate, none will be roaming wild in 2025. Who's willing to bet with me that there'll be elephants in 2025? This is a myth, but it's accepted. It's accepted. So the power of wildlife to make us accept what is essentially a myth is still something that I struggle to understand. And you wonder, does those one every 15 minutes include the ones killed by sport hunters? I don't know. Or is it just the ones killed by local poor people? The ones killed by rich people is fine. They're paying for it. Myths. This appeared in the news. A lone bull from Kenya braves Somalia, goes into Somalia for the first time in 20 years. What? This is the sort of thing that it's like discovering Kilimanjaro, discovering Lake Victoria. The sort of, that elephant has been going where he wants for the last 40 years. He's been to Somalia, he's been back, he's been several, but suddenly because there's a certain prominent person who saw him do that, suddenly it's new because so-and-so saw it. February 2016, a hidden lion population discovered in Ethiopia. And saying at least 100 lions found and discovered and seen by people in Ethiopia until 2016. Really? There are 80 million people in Ethiopia. I think someone has seen them or heard them roaring at night. But this is the sort of drivel that conservation has come and to start thriving on. I've heard a term used. We are now like we are in the post-truth world. Conservation entered the post-truth world ages ago. The rest of the world is just getting there now. We were there a long time ago. Yeah. Truth has very little place in the conservation the way we currently practice it. And myths have been the basis by which small populations, as in a few colonial officers, controlled entire countries. I think Britain had less than 2,000 colonial officers in India. They controlled that subcontinent with hundreds of millions of people in it. It's because of myths. This is one of the myths from way back then. The man called John Boyes, back in the early 1900s in Kenya, and he called himself a king and posed with a lot of Kikuyu people. He said he was an ivory trader, and this was a demonstration of power always. When you shoot elephants, it shows that you're a great guy. And he managed to convince people of his... He was apparently very charismatic. He managed to convince a lot of people to come and pose with him there and call him their king, although he was sort of borderline crazy. But he got away with it for some time before he got discredited by the colonial government. So it's typically one of his hunting camps, typically hunting those big tusks and posing for those pictures sort of to glorify him. And now here's a photo from 2016. Do you see any similarity? Isn't this burnishing someone's reputation for whatever reason? That's 2016. Those are sensible, and I expect sane people. Those are board members of the Kenya Wildlife Service. And Richard Leakey sitting there is the myth in the middle. And the fact it's only conservation that can accept this. If someone like even the CEO of a bank did that, he'd be laughed out of office. But conservation, we can still take such fables seriously. And that's why, in my experience, and these are not things that I've known for a long time. They came to me as in the course of my work. That's why when we do stuff like this and call it conservation education, showing these kids animals, then not realizing that on the way home, these kids actually just meet these animals. What were we telling them? So when going home, I met these kids there, and they're sort of waiting for the elephants to get across, so I gave them a ride past the elephants, etc. So they know about elephants. We're not coming to tell them about elephants. What we need to do is to educate people on how to live with these elephants, especially when new people and new generations who may not have the indigenous knowledge of how to avoid conflict, etc. But we go around showing kids who live in the Maasai Mara, and we show them giraffes and tell them, yeah, there's a giraffe, and we're really happy about it. They see the giraffe every other day. Science is the place where I come from, and that's why I have very harsh words for it in the book. And we refer to the prostitution of science. Science in conservation has gotten down to just chasing the money. We're chasing the next grant. We're schmoozing the next film star. We want to get that high profile. We tell whatever stories we need to tell to get money, and the grants become ends in themselves, because the grants subsidize a lifestyle of flying planes, driving nice big cars, flying helicopters, and being in movies. That's what the grants do. The grants don't actually solve problems, because if you realize that if a problem got solved, the person would become obsolete. So we need to maintain a crisis. We need to maintain the figure. So like local conservation statutory bodies have started using it as well. So when they're building a railway across Savo National Park and people complained that it's crossing elephant migration routes, yeah, the director is there posed with an elephant that had been darted and is being collared. Okay, so problem solved, we've collared the elephant, whatever reason. Encroachment into Nairobi National Park, lions were suddenly straying out of the park and causing problems. Director poses with a sedated lion while collaring it. We have collared the lions. Problem solved. And further afield, if you look at this talks about a project that someone's discovered an accurate age estimation for African lions. It's urgently needed to address conservation issues. This will help the management of lions and promote sustainable hunting. This is a project sponsored by Safari Club International. So we scientists have been reduced to just saying what the guy who gives the money wants. That's the sad situation. You may have heard of Cecil the lion that was shot sometime in Zimbabwe by some doctor from Minnesota. As a result of that outrage, David MacDonald and the Oxford University Carnivore Research Unit quickly jumped on it, and they got $1 million in donations by the time that article was written because of people's outrage over the death of Cecil. Now, this is absolute self-interest. That money could have gone to managing that park better, or paying for better patrols or something. But it went to Oxford because of a lion shot in Africa, in Zimbabwe. We go to extraordinary lengths, including development of new technology. This one was launched, some years ago at the World Parks Congress in Durban, 2003. That's where I first saw it. It's a device that's meant to help you get assistance from local people without needing to talk to them and burden yourself with discussing and sharing intellectual discourse with them. You just give them that, it shows you little cartoons of elephants, and you tell them, okay, when you see the elephant, just press that, and that kind of thing. So that's what the big thing they were advertising there. And why do we try so hard, invest so much in technology, to develop a way not to talk to people? Because we imagine that conservation is about animals. We do not need to talk to people. This is exclusive to Africa. There's very few conservation issues that are handled anywhere else without talking to people. These are the questions we have to ask ourselves. And lastly, chapter 7 of the book talks about what's this all about? There's a lot of expansion of what we call conservancies. Wildlife conservancies in Kenya right now. And that just compares Kenya. The map on the left is Kenya oil exploration blocks. There's been a lot of oil finds in Kenya recently. The one on the right is wildlife conservancies managed by Northern Rangelands Trust. Well, you can see for yourself. In the northwest of Kenya, the conservancies, a number of conservancies there are actually funded by Africa Oil, the oil exploration company drilling oil there. So what are we doing? At what point did we lose sight of the fact that this is about natural resources and stewardship of natural resources? When did it become an industry? More so an industry that is supported by donor funds, given by some well-meaning individuals, sometimes given by governments from taxpayers' money of their citizens. And then we have some few people using this for very simple, primitive material gain. These are questions we have to ask ourselves. So, and these are some of the things we raise in the book. We don't have conclusive answers on what one must do. I think it's that there's a lot in this book that arose from our personal feelings and experiences, and it's just an appeal to people, to everyone, to sort of look in themselves. And look, be skeptical. Being skeptical is a good thing. I don't think anyone is skeptical about something they don't care about.
if you don't care about something, you won't be skeptical about it, you won't examine. But examine things closely, because the things that we have long passed the point where you could give money and the worst that could happen is your money getting wasted. Right now, the worst that could happen is your money could be used to violate human rights. Your money could be used for injustice. That's where we are now. And there's some of the things we raise in the book and that we'd like our readers to think about, and that's the coffee we'd like you to wake up and smell and hopefully do something about it in your own little way, because every little intellectual input into these discussions makes a great difference. Last year, in the development of this book, as I said, it happened, but I made some very strong connections in the course of making this book. So I'd just like to acknowledge my co-author, John Barrier. Skeeter Wilson's a publisher based in the US, because no publisher in Kenya would touch this. Yeah, that was the truth of the matter. No publisher in Kenya would touch this. Trevor O'Hara is the editor who helped us editing. John Nyaga and Eddie Obinju did the cover illustration. The Center for Advanced Studies in Environmental Law and Policy in the University of Nairobi is where we launched the book. And seemingly, thus far, academic spaces have been the only places where we've been able to have these discourses. So because of that, I also sincerely thank HDNR and Colorado State University Africa Center. And there's a small group of people we consult regularly with on these issues and call them the errant natives. Conservation is not a lie. What's a lie is the way in which we practice it. That's what's very important to remember. Conservation is very important. But the way we practice it so far in Africa has not been honest. It's the arrogant belief in our own hype, in our own infallibility, and going right against things that we do know are not true. And the diminution of local people never works, because they're the custodians. No tourist ever conserved anything. They just come and see it and go. The people who conserve it or destroy it are the people who stay there and are its custodians. So there's been a lot going on in Kenya. There have been some violent clashes in resource conflict in Kenya recently with conservancies and pastoralists, sadly leading to some deaths of people. But this is where it's at. It's sad that it's happening, but I know for a fact that I've been speaking about it in various forums for the last 3-4 years. And sadly through violence, but it's now getting to the public domain. And a couple of days ago, one of the local newspapers in Kenya, after those clashes happened, the UK Foreign Minister Boris Johnson came to visit the conservancies, strangely. And this cartoon appeared in one of the national newspapers in Kenya just on the 21st, a couple of days ago. And yeah, you can see they're telling colonial baggage is not allowed in here. So people are waking up. It's taken time and it's still a long process. But this is what's happened. People are beginning to see that something's wrong. And I think there's no problem in this world that has ever been solved unless you first acknowledge that there is a problem somewhere. And lastly, that's my email address and my co-author's email address, and we have a Facebook page where we have all the arguments and hell abuse back and forth about the issues in this. Okay, there's no abuse, but it's all your opinions are welcome, either by email or social media. And thank you all for coming and for your time.
Yeah, and we advertise until 3:30, so we got time for Q&A, but if you do need to head out, feel free to do so. We've got a lot of operate on the hour.
So you talked a lot about donor accountability. You talked a lot about myths. It seems like one of the myths that's particularly damaging, at least from the donor perspective, is that win-win solutions are common. I'm not saying they don't exist, I am saying I think they're really rare. So, if there is one thing that you wish donors to AWF TNC Africa and so forth, you know, what would it be besides this? What is the one thing that you hope that they would be more informed on?
I think first of all would be that when you're talking about habitat, you're talking about a finite resource. Whether it's land or national park, or it's a finite resource. So when these organizations talk about winning space for wildlife, somebody's losing. They need to simply ask, so where's this land coming from? You're not growing it in petri dishes or anything. They need to ask those questions. And even though I know donor organizations might be very loaded, I think as a rule of thumb, I think if they gave a $5 million grant to someone, give at least $100,000 to an independent monitor.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Even just 0.5% of a grant given to someone to check this out, to audit this stuff. As things are now, Northern Rangelands Trust has a $20 million grant from USAID. There is no monitoring of that outside their own staff. Well, and most of us here have done projects. I've never even done a $10,000 project without having some challenges and some things going wrong. But you see these reports on millions of dollars and five-year projects, and everything worked perfectly. No challenges. And it's, life's not like that, certainly not in the conservation field. So I think more credibility and if they just dedicated a certain amount out of every grant, just a rule of thumb amount towards monitoring what's going on, it would save them a lot of grief, because once grant agreements are signed, it's not easy to renege on them or for whatever reason. So the grant officers become sort of captives of their grantees, because if you start saying there's a problem, the next question is, you're the one who gave them $20 million, can you explain why there's a problem? I know that that's very much the culture in USAID. The officers are almost desperate for this thing to work and look good. It's almost like delays and the problems that just come up in nature are almost not, there's no space for them in that system. So it's very important. I think more caution when giving money and some ethical things, because like Northern Rangelands Trust, I talked to the CEO a few weeks ago and he told me, I asked him, what's the strategic plan? And told me there's no strategic plan. This was actually an experiment and it's grown organically and it's become huge. And I thought, conservation is the only field where we can actually smile and admit that we are doing experiments with people's lives and people's resources and people's livelihoods. It's appalling, regardless if it goes well or badly. We can't experiment with people, but we admit doing it in conservation. We couldn't do that in medicine or commerce or whatever. Yeah.
So thank you very much for your presentation. I thought it raised some really very important issues that need to be shouted. I'm Namibian. I worked in South Africa and Ghana and Kenya, and I've worked with organizations like Conservation International and WWF, and I feel that your portrayal is not necessarily representative of across Africa, the initiatives that conservation is trying to implement. For example, you showed the picture of the GPS tracker and the Khoisan hunter-gatherer, and I was part of the group that was working on that, and the idea was to try and promote the livelihood opportunities in the protected areas so people could conserve their traditional way of life, but they still had some form of income, and they were tracking the wildlife themselves. And I feel that there's been other examples. For example, Ezimbeto KZN Wildlife is working with tribal authorities to, you know, gain revenue, and they determine the grazing management regime for cattle in conservation areas. And WWF is doing the same in terms of water catchment management, trying to, you know, use extended public work programs so that there are livelihood opportunities in conservation areas. And you spoke about that there is a large divide in the white and black populations in conservation, and I totally agree with that, but I do think that conservation organizations are trying to address this. They've got internship programs to get more black people involved in conservation, and you have, you know, percentages, even in Kenya, you've got, you know, 10% of community conservation areas are designated local communities. So I think what you're saying is extremely important, but I feel that you haven't represented the heterogeneity of the continent, and that you haven't represented the initiatives, which we both come from a generation of people which have been trained that we do have to integrate livelihoods in conservation.
Yeah, thanks for your opinion. Okay, one thing I can tell, the only true thing one can tell you about the whole of Africa is that it's big and it's diverse. The South Africa, for various historical political reasons, is very different from the rest of Africa. When I was there at that presentation in 2003, that was the selling point. They don't need to learn anything. There's pictures. And one thing from having done some work in Botswana and certain parts of Namibia, I know the San people can track wildlife almost by divining. I don't know how they do it. I don't think that guy needs a GPS to find an elephant. I think you could talk to him and he could tell you that they've gone this way. That, in my feeling, would be the intellectual discourse with that guy, if that particular guy in the photo. But I agree that they could have had those intentions, and there's a lot of the things that go on in conservation in Kenya particularly are very well intentioned. It's the implementation that's a problem. I talk about the divide black people, white people involved in it. It's not about numbers. It's about the decision-making positions. Certainly in talking about Kenya, it's the even the highly qualified black people are in administrative. They don't decide policy, they don't do budgets, they don't do proposals, they don't do work plans. That's just how it is in these organizations, the ones that I'm familiar with in Kenya, and including WWF. Including AWF, and it is a challenge. And the thing is, they're operating like that. And as I said, I don't blame the organizations. I more blame the wider, the government or our structures or our systems that have allowed that to happen. And that's why some things end up happening that local people fall through the cracks. Those conservancies that are called locally run, they're not. They even have a car that is registered under the name of the Northern Rangelands Trust. They don't have bank accounts. The bank account, the auditor, everything, Northern Rangelands Trust. Northern Rangelands Trust signs the checks, pays everyone from the manager to the guards. So the people, it's locally run only by name, honestly. And that's where the challenge is, and that's where we need to dig deeper. Yes, Kina, and you'll come to this side. Yeah.
Yeah, I think part of the problem is actually not, well, one is our perceptions, you know, of each other, and people, you know, especially white people from the West, realizing that, you know, your perceptions of indigenous people in Africa are deeply ingrained for generations, and then also providing the time to actually work with communities on a real level. You know, I also have worked in Tanim, Botswana, and I've worked with WWF and and Conservation International, and those sorts of groups, and I actually was in Botswana on a Conservation International project where they basically created a whole cultural village for the Bushmen, and thought they had spoken to the Bushmen about whether or not they actually wanted to live in the village and be a part of this cultural village, But in reality, when I went and talked to the bushman...
That's a village for tourists to visit.
Yeah, it's a village for tourists to visit. Yeah, I mean, you know this, right? We don't have to have the discussion, right? So, I talked to those same people, and they were like, no, we're never going to live in a village. We're never going to do it. I didn't speak Sisarwa at the time. You know, I was just learning it, and I sat with, you know, friends, like, not as like, hi, I'm here to tell you something. I sat with friends who helped translate, and I talked to the elder women, and they said, yeah, of course we're not going, because we're not animals, that we don't want to be in a zoo. So the point is that while we think we might be doing, you know, great things for the community, and the community communities might be paying lip service to conservation organizations, if you're not working with local people, or if you're not working with people that those communities actually trust, you're not going to get a real answer. You're not going to get an honest answer. You're not going to get an honest like display of like what they really want, you know. And what needs to happen in conservation is people need to actually spend the time with communities and let communities figure out how to conserve their wildlife instead of coming up with one grand idea after another.
Yeah, thanks for that. Yeah, the donors also need to understand that, Jake. Time, money can't buy time. You just have to invest some time, talk to people. Yes, you and Lenny.
So what I'm hearing from the presentations and the comments definitely sounds like getting the local people to be the masters of conserving their own natural resources sounds like more of the more ethical way to go about conservation, also the more practical way to go about conservation, because it sounds like the local people who live in those areas, they know the animals already. They don't have to read about it in a textbook or go to class. They live with them every day. So as a white man in America wanting to go, I want to go abroad, work for World Wildlife Fund and work for Wildlife Conservation Society and solve some of the problems that I see. There's species that are declining. There's all kinds of biodiversity issues all around the world, as well as human livelihood problems. People are poor. But what is the role of an American abroad? What are we needed? And if so, how?
Very good question. Maybe I'll take this one as well, then I'll answer both of them.
I have an opposite question. All that we've talked about, these international NGOs or government organizations, are all still those white people you were talking about. What's the role of black and brown leaders who are in charge of every nation in Africa? What's that role?
Yeah, okay. Thanks for the question. First of all, I think it's the pitfall that we've fallen into, especially with when you contact these large organizations, is that they tend to tell you it's simple. I don't know how we conspire so much to simplify this thing. It's never is simple. That's why as Kina just said, some people came and said, it's a nice spot, let's build a village here, and they come and live here. No, there's a reason why they don't live there. Or there's a reason they live where they do live right now. A lot of places and a lot of these organizations presume empty slate. When they come in, let's form a conservancy. And we'll form a conservancy and let's have a chairman and secretary and all. Traditionally, there were no chairmen and secretaries of these areas. There were elders. And the organizations actually form councils of elders. They create councils of elders. I was, by virtue of my office, I was once in a council of elders. Not to mention, I don't meet the age threshold, and I wasn't from the particular place, the particular part of Kenya, but I was in the council of elders, making decisions on where people can graze the animals and where they shouldn't graze the animals. And these are problems. So it's about oversimplification. So I think the thing is, you need to be prepared to invest time. You say, I want to get my PhD by age 30 and I'm going to do it there with that community. No, that doesn't happen. I want to go and study what's going on there. And just be prepared to invest time. The question about the leaders and the state bodies,
very key question. I think talking about Kenya, I think they have failed. I think the I showed you the picture of the president signing that thing. Standing next to him is the lady was the minister for environment. Next to her was Richard Leakey, the chairman of Kenya Wildlife Service, and they're all signing onto this paper, brought in by some civil society organization that just started a few years ago, and it's based in England. And these are head of state. So there's a failure. These ethical breaches are happening because there is a vacuum that is leaving space for that. And I think as for where that vacuum comes from, I think it has been failure of even our educational institutions to start teaching conservation policy, human dimensions, the sort of things they teach. We teach wildlife management, whatever that is. That means this is how you fence, this is how you do this, and there's animal handling and all that. That's technical. But policy, in talking about Kenya, there's a definite policy vacuum within which these things are happening. So they're probably, if I'm to apportion blame, number one is our state organs.
Can I speak to the other part of your question about, you know, just in general black leaders in Africa? And, you know, I wasn't born in Africa, but I am African. And, you know, when I first arrived to do conservation work in Africa, I was called every name in the book. As soon as people figured out that I wasn't like, oh, can you help me? Can you mentor me? You know, sort of, that I had a PhD and a master's. I found it the most difficult thing on the planet to get work actually in Africa, where people trust me and I can blend in and communicate in a different way with people. And I think that conservation needs to really acknowledge its sort of like prejudice in that way. It's like we all hire people that we feel comfortable with. And I think for lots of sort of well-educated, you know, black people in Africa, from wherever they're from, whether they're actually born in Africa or not born in Africa, it's extremely difficult if you're not sort of in the role of like the I don't know anything indigenous person that can be educated.
Yeah, you need to subservient and yeah, that can. Yeah. Please, Kathleen.
Thank you for your talk. And my question is around a lot of what you presented was sort of fortress conservation
that
you built fences around. And but yet some of the conversation is about like community-based conservation. And we know that there's limited win-win even in that realm of conservation. So what does win-win mean, and what are some steps that can be taken for us to get there?
Okay, yeah, it raises a very important point that in Kenya, talking about Kenya, we have this really worrying sort of almost incestuous bleeding of conservation and tourism into each other. One's a business, one is a principle. And that's why we fail on the livelihoods angle, because conservation people come to a place and they want to turn these local people into tour guide, driver, chef, waiter, whatever, in the tourism industry. We are ignoring the livelihoods which have been there. Like, for example, in northern Kenya, of that $20 million that's gone in there, and it's more than 20 because there are other donors as well, there's no significant amount that has been put into streamlining, strengthening, modernizing the livestock production that dominates that economy in there. They're trying to supplant livestock production and substitute it with conservancies which are created for tourism. And tourism, if I had any business acumen in me, tourism would be the last business I'd get into. It's so fickle. You have Ebola in Sierra Leone, tourism crashes in Kenya, even though Sierra Leone is actually closer to the US than Kenya. that a terrorist attack might happen in London. Tourism to Kenya crashes. And when one expects that, and the other thing is skill sets. If you go to northern Kenya in Samburu, the skill in livestock production, livestock husbandry, is been developed for generations. Why do you want to come and start teaching this guy to be a chef instead of strengthening the livestock production industry and creating some profitable fair trade that can maintain offtake to avoid obvious overstocking? But there is a definite aim in Kenya that's where I think conservation is really failing in Kenya, that they're not looking at existing livelihoods. And especially most of the wildlife areas are pastoralist livestock production. So they're actively trying to strangle livestock production. And that's where the violence that you may have read about in the news is coming up. That these are the identity of a people. It's the identity. And I tell you, any Maasai or Samburu man who might be anywhere, even like my friend Michael there, I bet he has some livestock back in Samburu. That's identity. It's not something you come and tell people, okay, now we'll start tourism and all this kind of thing. And a lot of the deals which have been brokered by conservation organizations, these leases, they're very unfair leases. If you see a lease to lease some land far up in Samburu and you find the document is elaborately written in English that even illegally is English, like even I would have trouble with it. You can't imagine that community signed on with prior informed consent. But this is what we in conservation are currently doing. So I think we need to tack anything we do onto existing livelihoods. And these are areas where, as long as that guy can do his livelihood, no one's going to bother with, no one's interested in shooting the elephants or killing them. That's why they're still there anyway. But we are creating enmity, where we are creating insecurity, where someone sees his livelihood is being actively suppressed. He'll get to some point, he's going to rebel. That's generally how things work, and I think that's what's going on. I think the problem of ignoring existing livelihoods and like what I'm describing, helping build up the livestock production system would take time. But somehow we seem to be unwilling to invest time, especially once we see a big grant. So here's $20 million. Can you do this in 6 months? Yeah, easy. Yeah. Easy. Organize meetings, call guys to hotels, bring a plane, fly them down there, do this, that. Yeah, please.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention one thing. So you talked about the oversimplification of conservation and conservation problems and solutions in particular.
Yeah.
With the note of defense. And I appreciated that comment very much. And I worry that one of the big oversimplifications, or really it's a logical fallacy, is how much conservationists we use this dichotomy, this false dichotomy of we're going to use local-based approaches, or we're going to use top-down approaches, or we're going to use spare-the-land approaches versus share-the-land approaches. And I really think that if we're going to accommodate 11 billion people on this earth, and we're going to try to make room for wildlife, that we're going to have to use a mixing of these things,
yeah.
And we have to stop with this dichotomy of, you know, local solutions are always going to work, or top-down solutions are always good. It's not going to work that way.
Absolutely, and tourism is one that really plays into that in Africa. You see these brochures and you see this pristine landscape, no sign of a village, a house, a cow, dog, any sign of human presence. And sometimes they're actually photoshopping people out. I know places in Kenya where I've seen brochures, I say, I know that place, there's a guy who lives on that corner, and right now I don't see him. Yeah, so we need to stop selling that product. Yes, please.
I give you an example a little further to the south. Uh-huh. Are you familiar with the Ruaha National Park in Tanzania?
Yes.
There is a major problem there. The river was drying up, and annually there was less and less concern. I was working on an irrigation rice irrigation project called Mati Bira, and finally there's supposed to be 10,000 hectares of irrigated rice authorized. Somebody got an aerial photograph up above there. there were 40,000 hectares of irrigated rice, 30,000 informally developed. And this was, of course, taking away the water that was going into the national park. Now, are you going to go down there and tell this smallholder farmer he can't grow his rice so that you can preserve the ecology in the national park?
For tourists.
Huh?
Yeah, for tourists to come and see.
For sure, for sure.
it's very difficult. That's just the thing.
It's totally unenforceable,
yes, yeah.
Except for little bakshis to allow the guy to get you.
Exactly. Let me just take that, Stacey's then yours. Yes, Stacey, please.
Thank you, Morty, for presenting this. I'm curious about your opinion related to the role of education, training, research and science, coming from both the local perspective and, say, institutional perspective and organizational perspective, to actually make some change. I mean, there seems to be an institutionalized structure upon which everybody functions in terms of conservation. You know, the way that funding works, the general way that people undertake doing research or getting their education or interacting with communities. And so what do you see as...
That rigidity, it really is a serious challenge, and it's one I've knocked my head against several times, and because some things stay constant, like let's say in physics, those laws of physics are constant. Conservation, even year on year, there's a drought year, there's a wet year, there's more people now, there's less people, and all that kind of thing, so. There needs to be a lot more flexibility in it, and I think in conservation biology is a problem because conservation is not biology. We need to do away with that box in our minds, conservation biology. Conservation is not biology. That's a small fraction of it. We need conservation to expand to cover a much wider spectrum. And credit to this institution, this is the widest spectrum in my experience that I've seen conservation cover. But that's the reality. That's the reality now. I remember when I did my master's work, I was doing work on carnivores and the conflict with the livestock. So I ended up talking to people, and I kept getting this pushback. That's not part of your proposal. This housing method reduces losses of livestock by a certain number, but it's not statistically significant. And I've talked to villagers and tried to explain that, okay, this works, but it's not statistic. And someone asked me, like, what number of goats is that is not significant? How many do you mean? And then, that's the sort of moment when I realized, okay, this is like for us, it's not for the community. So it's very important to include we must invest a lot more heavily in the social science part of it. A lot more heavily. And for some reason, there's a lot of shyness in amongst people working in Africa to do that. I'm not sure if it's because of the diverse cultures and the amount of time it would take. But I think it does take time, I agree, but it's worth the investment. Without that, there are projects where donors have sunk $2-3 million and right now it's zero. Collapsed. Nothing survived a month after the end of the funding. And there's no funding that's infinite. One wonders these huge areas, when the funding dries up, not if, when it dries up, what's gonna happen? Because you've dismantled the structures, you've created new elders who are not elders, you brought in people like Mordecai who are young people from other parts of the country, made them elders and all that. The elders who are there in the society may have abdicated their roles and discipline breaks down and everything. So we may actually be creating a problem. It might actually be better if we never intervened once this funding runs out. So we need to scramble right now to prepare for that, yeah.
So in a lot of these situations, obviously there's a conservation intervention that's happening, and that must be because somebody has identified an ecological problem that needs to be addressed. or the people identifying the ecological problem, or people like conservationists, or maybe somebody from the outside that says, I want a lot of money, I want to solve this problem here. And with the local people, a lot of times the conservation problem comes from local people's practices because they have more immediate needs, more immediate concerns like their livelihoods, their future, their children's future, their education. You know, they're hungry or they have things that they care about that are more important. And one of the arguments that I've heard for internationals or the experts coming in and experts coming in to tell the local people what you should do or to give guidance is because, well, these people, the experts, they have the training so they can see more broadly, they can see many generations down the road, and that might be something that's an asset that the local people don't have. Now, how can you reconcile, can you tell a local community to shift their behavior, to look further into the future, or can you expect them to figure out something like that on their own?
Yeah, I think the problem is experts, when they come in, they have a lot of experts in, they have a lot of in-depth knowledge about a particular thing, species, maybe hydrology or something, but the breadth is what is lacking. That's why they need to invest more time in finding out from these local people who've grown up. Like, you can't put a lodge up there because we may not be living there right now, but we're not living there because that's our dry season grazing area. When things get really bad, we use that forest. So expert comes in, conservancy. That spot up there would be perfect for a lodge. So they build a lodge up there. Tap the spring up there to make a swimming pool for the lodge. And think, now we've helped these people. Drought comes along, these guys have nowhere to go. Because the lodge is sitting on the spring in the forest that they used in dry season. That kind of thing. So I think expertise, if expertise comes in, first of all, it has to be broad. A number of experts should come in, and they must invest in finding out things there. I've had experiences where local people say something that seems completely absurd at first, and then later on you find out that wow, that it actually is true. Because I was looking at loss of livestock, and some areas the people would steadfastly not keep dogs, and I thought dogs were really good vigilance aids. And they said, like, in this area, if you keep dogs, leopards actually like eating dogs. So a leopard's going to come in if you have a dog. Mm-hmm. Or else, if you keep a dog that's a smart dog, it will hide under the bed. It won't bark when a leopard comes. So there's little stuff like that. You'll never know unless you sit there and observe. We have to invest so much more in observation. And it's great that we come in with our technical skills and background. That's really useful in interpreting what we find. But we have to go and find the stuff, then interpret it. Not come with solutions and sort of try and if something works in a given place, as you see those big areas I've shown you, it means someone came and tried something here and it worked great. The next thing, you're trying it over there. Even in this room, I might not be able to apply something here and copy and paste it and apply it with this group. People are different. That's a human condition, and that's a mistake. When something goes right, we say, great, now we've done this, it costs $1 million, we need $20 million now to do it 20 different places. And then it all goes south from there.
Morty, let's do kind of questions afterwards, on our advertised time, so we can kind of move on. But thanks for coming today, Morty. We'll
Thank
be around
if we've got
more.